believe that there are some keys to getting prayers answered in the spirit. I believe beyond a shadow of a doubt, if you are tired of prayers being unanswered, you need to pay attention to what I'm preaching to you tonight, because I'm going to give you something that gives you a key on how to get prayers answered from God. There was a very powerful prophet that lived back in the 50s and 60s, died way too young. His name was Verbal Bean. He was a very powerful man of God. He was a man of prayer. He was a powerful man of prayer. He said there were two types of prayers that God answers. He said there are two types of praying that will get God's attention. He said the first type of prayer that God answers is a memorial prayer. It's something that you pray about over and over and over, and then God answers it. He said, like Cornelius, when he prayed so many times that the angel of the Lord said, your prayer and your giving has come up as a memorial before God. He said it was like this. He said, if a man wanted to buy a suit but could not afford the suit, he would go into the suit store with the money he had and put the suit on layaway with the funds that he had. Next time he got paid, he would put some more funds down on the suit. He would not leave with the suit. He would leave without the suit each time he went in to make a payment. But the more payments he made on the suit, when he could make them, there would become a day when he would finally pay off the suit. And when the last payment was made, he could take what he had been paying for home with him. He said, that's how it is in your prayer life. You can be praying about something over and over and over and not take the answer home. If you keep praying and you keep believing, there's going to come a day when you'd bring the answer home with you because you've paid it in full. Hallelujah.
Nation with truth and justice shine. the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
Oh. Jesus. Hallelujah. God, we thank you right now for what you've done, God. And we thank you for what you're going to do in this place tonight, Jesus. We surrender to you, God. We surrender to you, Jesus.
High and holy King, you had it all and you left everything. You walked the earth in me to make a way for me.
Yes. the depth of your heart, let's give him praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your grace, your mercy, your goodness. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad to be in the house of the Lord? Amen. Thank you for braving the wet weather, the cold weather, to be in a one beautiful, red-hot Holy Ghost service. My, isn't it good to feel the Spirit of the Lord in this place? Good to have each and every one of you. God bless you. We're thrilled to know that Jesus is in the house, and he's what it's all about. Praise God. Praise God. Good to have Brother and Sister Bustard with us. I know most don't know her. Wave your hand, Sister Bustard. So good to have them. And we're looking forward to a great service tonight and tomorrow night. And then both of our Sunday morning services. Wow, we're going to be in a time, have a time in the Lord. Amen, amen. Before Brother Hardwick comes at this time to take our offering, I'm going to ask you to be in prayer for Sister Cynthia Swallow. Her mother passed away this afternoon, and we want to lift Sister Cynthia and her entire family up in prayer. At this time, Brother Hardwick's coming.
Praise the Lord. I've been joining with Pastor, just thrilled that Brother and Sister Buster are with us tonight. We're asking our ushers to come at this time, and it might be cold outside, but it's red hot in here. How many of you want to get in the presence of God, lift him up, just see what God's going to do here tonight? All of our visitors that are with us, thank you so much for braving this weather, coming and being with us. You're with a group of people. We want to make a difference. If you want to make a difference, you're in the right place. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, just asking God to just bless everything here, bless this offering. This offering goes to our evangelist, Brother Buster and his wife. They are full-time evangelists, and this is how they live. They live and walk by faith. So let's pray right now. Lord, we thank you so much for this opportunity to be in your house, to lift you up and worship you. We give you glory and honor. We ask that you would bless this offering, Lord, for the furtherance of your kingdom. God, we pray that everything here that happens tonight, Lord, be anointed by you, and you get the glory in Jesus' name, we pray. Everybody say, in Jesus' name. God bless you. You can be seated as our ushers wait upon you. Brother Pavlu mentioned that Brother Buster will be with us tomorrow night at 7 p.m. We're going to have a great time, just a wonderful series of services. We're expecting great things to happen. Also Sunday at 9 a.m., 11:15. And then at 5 p.m., the first service for LifePoint for this year will be happening at the new location in Karen Crow. That's right. 3549 Northwest Freeway. Don't ask me how to get there. Talk to Brother Lewis. And you can like the Facebook, the LifePoint Facebook, and follow that and find out all the information. Pick up a newsletter on the way out. Get the app, and you'll find out everything that's happening. This time, we want to just stand right now. We want to just give the Lord some praise here for a moment. Can we do that? We're about to step into the next level of this service. It is my honor to bring Brother Buster to the pulpit at this time. Let's lift up Jesus right now, everywhere in the house. Lift your voice all over the house. Lord, we worship you and praise you.
Let's continue. Amen. Let's just give him praise. Thank you for keeping us through 2016. Thank you for every promise. Thank you for every blessing. Thank you for another year. And all of God's people said amen. Amen. If you don't mind remaining standing just for a moment, it's a privilege to be back in Church Point. And after all these years, I finally brought the vice president of Morton Bustard Ministries with me. That's my wife right over here. Amen. Let me give a heads up to the media booth. In a moment, I'm going to read from Romans chapter 4, verse 17. And then I'm going to go over to Hebrews chapter 6, verse 13 through 18. Amen. Thank you for coming out on this night with not so good weather. Amen. And we're probably doing this for the sake of the webcast and the video recording, but when I'm through preaching, if you don't mind bringing the house lights all the way up, that way there, I'll get to see who I'm supposed to be praying for. And if it's, who knows, it may be a guest, and it helps when you go to minister in the supernatural, when the lights are all the way up, because sometimes I spook people bad enough as it is. Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Brother Rick Pavlou, to your sweet wife, your family, the evangel, the entire leadership team, and to all of you. Now, I'm not on a time limit for tonight, but I'm going to respect your time and cram a whole lot into about 30 minutes. I say that because now Sunday morning, the first session, it's a little bit at times just, you know, sometimes we go up to the wire. But these night services, there is no pressure, but I respect your time. But at the same time, I want to give the Lord all the time that he needs. And he doesn't need to take as much time as I do, I promise you that. Romans chapter 4, verse 17. As it is written, I have made thee, Abraham, a father of many nations, before him whom he believed, even God, who quickeneth the dead, and calleth those things that be not as though they were. Would you pay a little extra attention to that last sentence? He calleth things that be not as though they were. Now over to Hebrews 6, verse 13, speaking of Abraham again. For when God made promise to Abraham, because he could swear by no greater, he swore by himself, saying, surely I will, blessing, I will bless thee, and multiplying, I will multiply thee. And so after he had patiently endured, he obtained the promise. For men verily swear by the greater, and an oath for confirmation is to them an end of all strife. It's over if you come into agreement. Wherein God, willing more abundantly to show unto the heirs of promise the immutability of his counsel, confirmed it by an oath, that by two immutable things, in which is it was impossible for God to lie, we might have a strong consolation, who have fled for refuge to lay hold upon the hope set before him. So that last part in Romans, he calleth those things that be not as though they were, and wherefore it is impossible for God to lie. Father, speak a word tonight, we pray, and bless these wonderful people. And all of God's people said amen. And before you're seated, would you give him about a 30-second thunderous round of applause? Praise the Lord. You may be seated. What a crazy November 2016 it was. What a crazy election cycle beginning back around 2015 through 2016. The two contenders that got the nomination for the respective parties both had high unfavorability ratings. And there was an issue with the trustworthiness or the lack thereof. That didn't begin in 2015. Somewhere in America, we stopped paying attention. Way back in the day, a man's word, a woman's word, that was their bond. That was almost as good as any collateral you would need at the bank. People would almost rather die than lie. Yeah. Yeah. If they lied, it would eat at them, smite their conscience. I was raised like that. My Uncle Dave, the last, he was I think the last living brother of my father, Uncle Dave, was way up there in years, and a bachelor all of his life. He lived in the middle of nowhere. But he went to bed one night, and his conscience was messing with him because he told something that wasn't 100% truth. And he just got up at 4 o'clock in the morning, and he walked over 4 miles, I think, one way. He had to set the record straight. See, in my world, there are people who put confidence in me. I would never want to lie to Marilyn, because you don't just tell a lie if you're not careful. You live a lie. My girls, they, I think, believe in Dad and pretty much think that the sun sets on him. I would not want to destroy that confidence. The ministers who turn their pulpit, they open it to me to preach, and they believe in this. And after 35 plus years of ministering in the prophetic, not being perfect, but being conscientious, wanting to do the right thing, operating in the supernatural, but not the sensational, giving a word of God speaks, if not, not faking it, not embellishing. I wouldn't want to destroy that. Whoever is going to lead our country had better be able to tell the truth. Because if you can't put confidence in a person's word, they might say the wrong thing and really, really mess us up. You see, without overworking this, in leadership, I have a certain dimension of power because I'm a speaker. And when I speak, I can edify, bless. But if I prevaricate or exaggerate, I'm in trouble. Whoever has a position of authority needs to take that very seriously, because words have meaning and words have authority and power. And we don't need a liar, but we don't need a hothead, short fuse to get us into a war because they threw a temper tantrum. But if I call things that be not, and I declare that they are, you might ask me to back that up. And if I can't back it up, I'm in trouble. So we have the supreme being of the entire universe with all power. Nothing limits him. And yet he can call things that be not and say that they are. Not going to tarry very long, but I like to just deal with this just a little bit, because what if there was a flaw in the Almighty? What if he didn't control his temper? What if he did have base emotions and could get hot headed and loose with the tongue and speak off the top of his head? There not only would be chaos in the cosmos, we could be in really bad trouble. First of all, we can trust the Almighty with this kind of power because he's not hot-headed. His essence is love. Perfect love. So anyone who has this kind of power, which is perfect power, ultimate power, it would have to be balanced with perfect love. I don't have perfect love. I am not a perfect person. I do have situations with base emotions, and I have mood swings, and I'm not always as temperate as I should be. And I get into those moments where if I could, I might call fire down from heaven and fry him like bacon, sizzle them right on the spot because they did me wrong. But when you're the Almighty and you have no opposite, and you don't have to contend for any position or try to maintain any great identity because you're in a class all by yourself. If you never have to prove anything and you possess perfect love, number two, he'll never get hot-headed because his word will never ever precede his will. His will precedes his word. God never says anything unless he thinks it all the way through. Now, it doesn't take him long to think something through, but God will never speak anything unless he has put all the thought required into it and the ramifications and the consequences and what might happen if he speaks. God's never going to go, oops, or uh-oh. God has never walked up to me and said, hey, Mort, would you strike that last sentence I just said to you? I didn't mean that. He has perfect love. And because he has perfect love, we have the fruit of the Spirit. He's got the tree. It's his nature. He is perfect. And if he was perfect to the nth degree, that would make perfect less perfect. He's just perfect. The same way you cannot be honest and more honest. Yeah. So, number one, he has perfect love toward you and toward me. Now, I'd like to talk about this perfect love for a moment because it cannot be improved upon. Just hang with me. While we were sinners, he had perfect love toward us. Nothing that I do can improve his love for me. Now, I can please him by walking in his will and in his word, but his love is already perfect. Somewhere, somebody is, you know, probably hitting, you know, doing some smack right now. God's love for that person, be it man or woman, is perfect. It doesn't matter what lifestyle they may be engaging in right now. God's love for that person is perfect. So stop trying to get him to love you more. He can't. And every word he speaks over this church, every word he speaks over this world, this country, your family has been thoroughly thought out from start to finish because he declares the end from the beginning. But we still haven't quite got to it. Someone who has the power to call things that be not and say they were, or in our maybe a little bit better grammar without going back to the KJV, they are. No, they're not. They are. Yeah. It doesn't exist. Yes, it does. It never happened. Yes, it did. It doesn't exist. Yes, it does. His perfect love, his will precedes his word. And if he just called something that was not and said it is, if his will precedes his word, it already is. I'm going to have a fit here. I'm not going to preach long, but I'm going to have a fit. Just because you can't touch it or see it or smell it or taste it doesn't mean it doesn't exist. There's a whole lot out there that we have not seen that exists. Matter of fact, there's more to his creation than what's under your feet and what your five senses encounter on a daily basis. You have not seen anywhere near the vast creation of God, but one day you're going to be released and step on a bars of bones and go, wow, that's why precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. We're just warming up. I've spent time traveling around the world preaching the gospel, and this little Canadian boy's got to see some pretty cool things. We've been over the fjords of Norway. I've seen the changing of the guard at Buckingham, and I've seen the Mona Lisa in Paris, and I sat and listened to a live performance of the Philharmonic in Vienna, Austria. That's really cool. But when I'm released, I'm going to get to see the fullness of God's creation. First of all, no man has ever seen God, nor can he, because flesh cannot see him and live. That's a twofold saying. If you ever encounter God, your flesh is going to have to die. If you have an experience with God, your flesh cannot coexist. But your terrestrial body cannot handle the creation of the celestial God. But he can be fully trusted with this kind of power because he has perfect love and because he never says anything off the top of his head. But ladies and gentlemen, he rules by executive order. He rules by fiat. His word will never return void. His name is above every name, but he exalted his word above his name. Because if a man cannot keep his word, his name has no credibility. But the reason why when you say Jesus and demons tremble is because they know he has never lied. And that's what I'm going to close with. The reason why he can be trusted with this type of power to speak, it's not just because he's perfect love. It's not just because he thoroughly thinks. It's because it's impossible. It's absolutely impossible. God cannot lie. Let God be true and every man a liar. I do not want to traffic in what I preached around this time last year when we did the whole thing about substance and evidence, but there's a reason why people lie. They lie to save face. And then a lie begets another lie. They lie to try to save themselves. It's a self-preservation act, but God has no reason to try to save face or to maintain credibility. There is none like him. Therefore, it is impossible for God to lie. So I tell you, you have a right to stand at the Church Point Pentecostals tonight and raise your hands to the heavens and say, every promise in the book is mine. Every chapter, every verse, every line. My home may not look like it's praising God. My home may not look like the glory of God abides therein. But God spoke it. Therefore, it might not be, but it is. My body still feels pain. That old cancer is still eating away at the inside of my organs. But I still am going to raise my hands and say, I am healed. I know it's not, but it is. Because God calls things that be not and say they are. It's already existing. The reason why he can say it is, his will preceded his word, and he willed it to be. And now all he has to do is just articulate it. Would you give him a hand clap in the house? Musicians, would you join me back up here? Singers, would you come back to the stage? Give him a mighty hand clap all over the house. Don't you tell anybody that I preached in 18 minutes. Hallelujah. Your financial miracle doesn't exist. Why? Because it's not, but it is. Something's cooking in God's kitchen. I caught the aroma. The check is being mailed out. It's on the way. You better get your oil equipment ready, because who knows what's about to happen in about 3 months' time. Louisiana takes a licking, but keeps on ticking. Cast down, but not forsaken. We're a seedbed of apostolic doctrine, apostolic power, apostolic Holy Ghost move. God looks down upon the churches that send missionaries around the world. God looks down at a little church on the side of the road right here, 800 South Main Street, Church Point, Louisiana, say, don't you worry about what's not, because it is.
Woo! Second type of prayer is a current prayer. He said a current prayer is the second type of prayer that God answers. It's a situation that you don't have a long time for God to do this. You need God to do it now. Does that make sense? Yeah, you can have a lost loved one. That's a memorial thing. You just pray until God does something. But you could have a situation where you need God to intervene now. And when you have that type of prayer, memorial prayer is not what you need. You can't just go bring the name up or bring the situation up in passing and say, God, I'm making another payment on this. I need you to come through. When the situation is desperate, it requires desperation in your prayers. A current prayer, you can't come with a situation, Brother Grant, that's tragic and real and severe, and come to God and give God a, you know, Lord, what we're going through right now, and I need you to come through because the deadline is this week, and we have an answer, we need some peace, we need a miracle, and walk out. There's no desperation there. You're giving God the right facts, but you're not giving God the heart behind the facts. You're showing God, I'm really not serious about this. Because a current prayer requires desperation. It requires you to be, I need an answer now. I don't have 60 years to pray about this. We need a miracle in our house. That is desperation. That's a current prayer. And a current prayer, God will hear. And I want to show you something, that the Lord answers prayers while you're praying them. I know that we've got God in this box, that if I pray today, he can come through by Thursday, or he can come through by tomorrow, he can come through by next month. But actually, God, the Bible said, I can hear you before you even say what you're going to say. In fact, I know what you're saying before you even ask.